The opinions and recommendations expressed by Dan are his own and do not necessarily represent the opinions of this station or any of the show's sponsors.
866-300-9298, 866-300-9298. We're going to get right back to the phones. We were talking to, who were we talking to? Lynn from Oregon. Lynn, you were talking about C&I stock, I guess. And I guess your question, Lynn, on that stock is whether you should sell it or not.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. So, it's had a great run. The railroads in general have done really well in the last 2 years. It's yielding about 1.5% still, so you are still getting some dividend. But, you know, if you're up 20%, what you may want to consider is, at least taking your 20% off the table. If this is money that, you know, you can't afford to let sit and ride. I think one of the things that's going to impact C&I is the Keystone Pipeline. And frankly, I think when we see the Keystone Pipeline, if that ever gets approved, then a year or so after that, I think we're going to start seeing some of the railways. You know, some of the railroads in general have done so well because of all the oil and natural gas they're moving around, and that's had a huge impact. But I like the company. It's a strong company financially. It has not been on my buy list for quite some time because I think that they're a little bit overvalued at this point. So I would say to you, if you don't have, you know, an 8 to 10 year time horizon, if this is retirement money, if this, you know, I'll leave it up to you whether you think, you know, this is a good time to take your profit and run and just hang on to the cash to see if things reset here in the next first quarter next year, and then maybe buy back into it if it starts dipping. It has been on a little bit of a downturn lately. So last week, at least in the last 5 or 6 days, it has been turning down a little bit. But so a great company, great stock, financially strong, but I think they're going to be facing some headwinds in the next couple of years and then hopefully to recover again.
Okay. The other one was one that has been on your buy list, and someone had called in and you thought maybe they should hold it, even though it is also up substantially because it is going to do better, and that's PBR.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You definitely got
to
hold.
To sell or to hang on as well?
I cannot. I have to say you got to hold that. I would not sell that. There's some bad news coming out on PBR right now. I suspect that you may be up considerably, but you may be down by the end of this week. I don't even care about it. I would hang on to it. I remember when that stock was trading at over $100 a share. It's not going to get near that at all, maybe ever again. But because of the oil reserves that they have control of, and you know the price of oil, not doing much has hurt them a little bit. But if I've got 8 to 10 years and I'm Holt and I own that stock, I probably would not get rid of it. If you want to hedge your bet and sell, you know, if you're up 20%, enough shares so you can get your 20% off the table, I would be okay with that. But I would also tell you that right now it's somewhere around $14 a share. If that thing comes down, you know, to in the 11 area, I'd probably be buying back. I'd be buying more of it and lowering your average share price. They're going through some political issues with all of with this company. And I think it's going to be a rough go, maybe for, you know, it's not, I don't want to say a rough go, but it's going to be very volatile. It's going to be all over the place. But I would not, if I owned it, I would keep it. Would I buy it now? No, because it's on its way down. I'd probably wait to see if it gets a little bit lower. But, you know, I would keep it.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate the call. Great stuff, folks. Listen, I mean, remember, and you know, Lynn obviously, she's up considerably, as a lot of people are on that stock, that have, you know, purchase that off my buy list from the last time it was on the buy list. But, you know, again, I never ever put anything on my buy list with the intention, with thinking that, wow, this is going to go up in the next month or so, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, and you're really going to make some money. Has that happened? Yes, it has. Has it happened where in a couple of months it's gone up dramatically and I felt like, hey, you got to get out of it, and I've put that out on an alert that you got to sell out. But that's not usual. Usually it's up, that's good, but I'm not worried about it because I'm thinking 10 years out, where is it going to be? So but great stuff. Let me go to Diane calling us from Ohio. Hey, Diane.
Hi, Dan. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure.
I think you pretty much answered. I had a question about PBR also, whether with this latest downturn I should be concerned or add to it, but you said to wait till maybe around $11.
Yeah. I'll probably you'll see it show back up on my buy list, but I will probably, it's going to have to be in the 1180 range and lower before I'm probably going to consider that.
Okay. Then I have a question about potash. And if I could ask about Cooper Tire and Battery also, and then I had the gifting question.
Okay.
I've had potash since May of this past year, and it's, you know, the only one that I'm really, you know, kind of getting clobbered on. so should I have about a 37% cash position right now. So I don't know. I asked you about potash some time ago, but should I just hold it and just not look at it?
Yeah,
I mean, I have in
one of the charitable trust pools that I manage, I have a considerable position in potash. So, you know, we're getting clobbered as well to the tune of, you know, 16-17% negative. I would not even consider selling it. It's paying a 4.4% yield. So, you know, you're getting some dividend. If you want to feel better about owning it, actually take the dividend in cash so you know that the money that you have is working for you. But, you know, potash, we always have to remember, it's kind of like oil in this sense, maybe even better than oil. It's not a commodity like aluminum, you know, or even coal. Potash is an absolute necessity. It's a part of the agricultural industry that is a necessity. I think we're going to have severe food shortages in the next 5 years when we look at India and, you know, throughout Asia. I just can't see getting rid of it. I'm not ready to buy more. I'm not buying into it. It's going to have to get down. Yeah, it's going to have to get below 28. I'm going to think about buying. It's going to have to get below 28. If it got below 28, I would probably buy with the assumption that it's even going to go lower, but not wanting to take the chance that it might not go lower. So I'd probably buy in and around 28, 30, give or take, and then if it goes down lower, buy again. But that's kind of where I am on that. So just don't look at it. If you're losing sleep over it, just don't look at it.
I'm not losing sleep. It's just
good.
Good. So anyway, okay.
Okay. Cooper Tire, was that the other one?
Yes. I've known a lot of it.
Yeah. I like Cooper Tire. I mean, you know, Cooper Tire was one that the day they announced the buyout, which was back in I don't know when it was, early June, I believe. You know, I put a sell immediately. I sent out an alert on my alert system because a lot of people, probably hundreds of people that have followed me for a lot of years own Cooper Tire, because Cooper Tire has been on my buy list so much over the last 10 years. So I know that a lot of people own it. So when it went up to $34, or I didn't then, but I knew it was going to, it did the next day. I said sell. I didn't even, there wasn't any question. Don't keep it thinking it's going to go to 38 or 40 or anything. Just sell it. Well, so a lot of people did sell out of it at that point and made an awful lot of money. It has come all the way back down to its pre-June levels. But they're struggling with this whole buyout and some misstatements and things like that. But I'm just hanging on to Cooper. I would probably I would buy back in at this level once I get some clarity from the courts on what's going to happen with, I won't go into all the detail, but there's a plant in China that the buyers thought they were going to have control over, which it doesn't look like they're going to, and there's, you know, it's a big issue. So, but anyway, till I get some clarity on that.
I just bought a little bit of it about a month ago, so, you know, okay. I'm up marginally.
Oh, yeah, so you're okay,
3%, yeah. 3%, so, you know, and again, because I bought it, you had talked about it, and it was on your buy list at the time that I did purchase it.
Mm-hmm.
So just ride that one out. I mean, I'm not going to.
Yeah. I would probably keep an eye on that, because I'm going to probably be adding to it, put that back on my buy list here once we get some clarity on the legal situation. The sad part about it only pays about $1.75% dividend. It's not a huge dividend, but at least it's playing something.
Okay.
Playing something.
All right. And then do you have time to answer the gifting questions?
Sure.
Okay. My mom is going to be gifting. There are three children and then 8 or 9 grandchildren, and she's going to be gifting. I don't know if it's going to be $10,000 or $14,000 mm-hmm. This year, before the end of the year.
Mm-hmm.
What is the best use for that money? Our daughters are 9 and 13. We just have savings accounts for them, you know, that we match whenever they make a deposit. They both work for money.
mm-hmm.
You know, we're teaching them to tithe and all those good things. So, but what would be the best thing to do with those funds for them and then for us?
Yeah, I mean, for you guys, certainly I would keep it on the sideline until, you know, let's look and see what the first quarter of next year looks like. Then I'd like to see you probably get it into your investment account at some point in time and start considering investing in some things that are on my buy list. But right now, I'd probably keep it on the sideline for sure until that time happens. And you're a regular listener, you'll hear that. As far as your children go, I would probably start to consider, once that hits their accounts, I would start considering a mutual fund, like a Timothy mutual fund. I'd probably consider that for the late January time of year, you know, headed into next year, not immediately, but I would probably consider opening an account at Timothy and setting it in one of their conservative growth funds, or maybe even their mid-cap, large-cap fund. I can't answer that now, you know, depending on what things look like by the end of the year. But that's what I would do with them, and just try to forget about it. I mean, is this money they're going to probably use for college?
Yes, probably.
Yeah.
Should we put it in our name or in their name?
Oh, well, if you can put it in your name, you're far better off by doing that.
It
depends. Yeah, so here's the deal. I mean, if you think your kids are going to be eligible for grant scholarships and some other things through school, eligible, when I say eligible, I mean eligible from your income standpoint. They're going to be eligible for those kinds of things from a financial perspective. Then don't put anything in their names, because if they have a nickel in their name, it may not disqualify them, but it's going to put them at the bottom of the list. So, but if that's not an issue, if it's not an issue in the sense that, look, you know, you guys make too much money, you and your husband make too much money, you know, they're not going to qualify for much anyway, then from a tax standpoint, I'd put it in their name.
Okay, and one last question on the gifting, and I can certainly ask our accountant, but do we, because it's going to be under, you know, it's not going to be over the maximum
mm-hmm.
that's allowed, do we even have to declare that, or it's just a non-issue?
No, you know, it's a non-issue.
All right.
It's a non-issue. Okay, thank you. Hey, I appreciate the call.
Thanks, Dan.
You're welcome. You're listening to Financial Issues, 866-300-9298. We're coming up on the news, 866-300-9298. Hang in there, and we're going to get to as many calls as we can. I've got one little interesting thing. I want to talk about some taxes that are being proposed right now. That is lunacy, by the way. But, like I said earlier, government needs money, folks. And we're going to have to play our part by just allowing them to throw all those needs on our backs, because we can't expect them to cut any spending. Financial Issues. We'll be right back after this.